Oh, okay, we're going straight back into it. Welcome back.
Yeah.
Welcome back, everybody, to the Archon Team League Championships Finals here from Plano, Texas. My name is Frodan, joined by Noxious.
Yeah.
You awake there, buddy?
I'm awake.
You had a long marathon of a series just now.
Yeah, it was a crazy series. I'm actually pretty happy about the result. Like, the games were really exciting. Like, winning four games in a row, that was pretty cool to watch.
Yeah, well, it was a very exciting thing to watch, even though ultimately Tempo Storm did fall, and they are in fourth place. They do get another chance tomorrow. Just has to win three in a row, which is really difficult. It's quite the gauntlet to go through to win three games in a row, or three series in a row, best of 11s, right, Amaz?
Yeah, but still not out yet. How we're doing the seeding brackets is that all teams have a chance, and those who perform well will have an easier time in the, you know, final bracket.
That's right. So we currently have the quarterfinal decided, which is Tempo Storm versus whoever loses this match. The winner of this match goes directly to semifinals, guaranteeing themselves at least top three, which means they have $30,000 in the bank.
Yeah.
From Amaz's bank. And in the grand finals, Cloud9's already cashed in, getting themselves $60,000. I made a mistake earlier. I said 90.
Right.
It's 60, which means 20 split, or however they just choose to distribute it. You know, maybe Life Coach doesn't need any money because he always denies people donating and whatnot because he's well off. So maybe he gives it all to RDU.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
It makes sense to make
up for the Mech Shaman losses.
Yeah. It's comfort money, right?
Something like
that. Yeah.
Wouldn't Mech Shaman losses mean that RDU gets less of a cut?
No.
It could be, but then, you know, he has to deal with all the hatred and, you know, all the mean comments.
Comfort money.
Yeah, it is. He can cry himself to sleep and wipe off the tears with the dollar bills.
Well, you won't cry if you're going to get first.
Everyone can still get first. Mm-hmm. This is like the very wild thing. The only thing that's set in stone is that Cloud9 is at least second. And they will be able to play for first tomorrow. We have one more match today. It's Value Town versus Nilum. We've been seeing Value Town and Nilum play. It's come down to this series to decide who's going to guarantee themselves a spot in top three. And I think this one's going to be another one that's really intense. I feel like both series so far has had their moments, some of their crazy moments. I think we look at the Dog versus Strifecrow from the first series, and then we saw Hyped versus
RDU with the low
rocket show. It was just like absolutely insane. We were going crazy at the bottom.
Were you? I didn't hear the screams, maybe, but
because you guys were screaming.
Yeah, I was screaming alongside you, definitely.
Yeah. But I hope you guys have enjoyed. Make sure to hashtag ATLC. So as we get ready for our third match of the day, we're going to take a look at some extra content we prepared as we get ready for Value Town versus Nilum.
This guy's toast.
Previously on the Archon Team League Championship, Firebat BM's Forsen.
Pretty rough. He's going to be exactly at one.
He can still top deck Fireball, right? Or he doesn't have any more Fireballs.
He's got no more of those. Oh, wait, no. One of them was given hit to him by Archmage. You're right. He could top deck Fireball for the lethal. That would be a crazy finish. So he can ice block Fireball once and find the other one with... card draw. And he finds it off the top. Not fall for that crap. And by repeating it, he's actually falling for it more and more.
Look at Firebat. Thank you. Whenever people do this, Forsen knows they don't have it. And now Firebat just has it. And now Forsen turns around and he's cheering. He sees the lethal.
this is just unreal. Oh, poor Forsen.
Later. Forsen would go even further beyond.
Being Forsen, you're probably just implosion.
Yeah, for damage. Don't even need to spawn the imps at this point. Nice job, Forsen.
That's perfect.
And now Zalay is gonna get... the patron wet dream. The problem is, he might not have enough room to spawn. We can dream.
Now he doesn't know what to kill.
Don't you?
What? Your first...
Forsen's out, he called his mom. He's like, Mom, I did it. You got your dad, he's got his mom. He's calling her, he's telling him, I did it. We're gonna move through to the possibility of a chance at this. And now he's gonna BM like Firebat BM'd him. But he doesn't realize Zalay is actually not Firebat. I'm sorry, Forsen, that's the wrong person.
Okay, Forsen. Attack the Yin Yang boss into something, come on. Like, he can miss it. He can lose internet connection. Other than that, wow, he's
and then
really
the rope hits. The rope hits.
Like, he's like a seagull. He's like a seagull killer with his victim.
He plays with it. I think all Hearthstone players are a bit like that.
Like seagull killers with their victims.
Forsen takes the game, doesn't misplay at the very end there, which is very good. That was a very technical play right there with the perfect APM.
All right, well, that was quite the trip down memory lane. I actually didn't catch the end. I remember watching the game between him and FireEye, but I didn't actually see the final ending of it, but I heard about it through the social medias. That's some poetic justice.
Yeah.
You know, no offense to your guys and Ark. Oh, I think it was more of a friendly banter, but in the end, I love that kind of stuff. Personally,
yeah, that was just Hearthstone can be fun, and that's one of the ways it can be fun.
More B. Basically, what we're looking for in Hearthstone is more BM, right? That's pretty much it.
Team
rivalry.
How about this? Less veiling of the emotions, for the sake of being really intense as a competition. You know, a lot of people are like, I don't want to tell them for information based off any reactions. They try to keep stone face. And to be honest, sometimes. Some players take it, very seriously. But then there's players who show their honest emotion on their sleeves. That's why they love guys like Kid Blue. That's why they love Life Coach. They're very expressive and emotive. It's very fun.
Yeah. So here I have to ask, do you just coin Wild Growth and get a shade down on turn two, or do you use up the innervate to get the shade as big as possible? Is that +1/+1 gonna matter, basically?
Oh no, coin Wild Growth is actually really good here. You play shade, and then whatever you draw, you should probably be able to play with the innervate, right? If you innovate shade, then if you draw like a 5 drop, your hand might get clunky and whatnot. So yeah, coin Wild Growth shade is still the classic move.
I think the most important thing to consider is that you don't really benefit too much off of getting the additional 1/1 on the shade through the innervate compared to the tempo gain that you can gain from picking up a 5 drop. And most likely what the innervate gives you in the future is flexibility to play whatever you draw, which is something that's going to be really important because Druid wants to be playing something every turn.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of the matchups where a lot of people sometimes say Druid is favored. I haven't found that they're, heavily favored, but a start like this is probably one of the ways you are. Like, if you're picking up a Shredder or something as boring as, like, Sylvanas or Emperor Thorsen, let's say, as a 6 drop, would also work out.
Okay, well, already, a couple of awkward decisions here. You want the Acolyte of Pain to draw cards more than once, otherwise it feels like a worse loot order.
Right.
But in a lot of cases, you don't want your opponent, or you as a Druid player, don't want to reveal your shade very early just so it gets chopped down by a Fiery War Axe. So both players are already kind of playing a game of chicken. It's like, well, do you have the Keeper? And if you don't have the Keeper, will you reveal your shade? Otherwise, I'm going to draw multiple cards.
Yeah, and if you play the Keeper, it dies to Fiery War Axe and the Acolyte.
So, Amos, what would you say? You played a lot of Druid. What's the higher priority? Is it denying the warrior card draw, or is it making sure that you have a big threat like the Shade?
Yeah, it really depends on your hand. If your hand is as clunky as Tigis right now, then you probably need to try and get some board control. And then, you probably have to use the Force sometime to clear, just because you can't rely on top decking too much. So I like the reveal on Shade here. And because now, with the Darnassus Aspirant, it's not like Dog can kill both of these creatures at the same time. So I like this.
Or so you think. I don't really think he's... I mean, he's got the slam.
Mm-hmm.
But that does mean he can't play the Gnomish Inventor. And it's like you said, you want to prioritize killing both the Shade and the Darnassus Aspirant, and that's going to take a priority again.
It's actually very clean here. He gets to play
if he plays the Cruel Taskmaster, I think there might have been a lack of a card draw. Because he could have slammed the Darnassus and... killed it with a Cruel Task and then killed the Shade with the Axe. But maybe the 1/1 dead is more meaningful.
It's also very much of a tempo game.
Right.
When you play Patron versus Druid and if Druid has nothing, you have all the time in the world to draw your cards anyways. The only way you kind of lose as a Patron warrior is that, Druids have one threat and every time you remove something, he plays another and then the combo just finishes you off, right? But if you're one step ahead in a tempo game, then that wouldn't be the case.
And the hand from Tai is actually not very board, tempo-centric, right? Like, there's no tempo there to be found. It's mostly just removal if something hits.
Yeah, it's true. I'm looking at this turn right now for Tice, and I just see that there's really nothing to do that's significant. There's no point of using any of his spells. So instead, he can opt to take some time, make Dog believe that perhaps there's some awkward turn that he doesn't want to do. Because if you just pass immediately, I think it's too telling of what kind of hand you have.
But now we're put in a spot where, you know, you just let the patient warrior do anything they like. And yeah, it's just, wow. That's just terrible.
Yeah, this might be the first time that I see Thais draw badly. Like, he seems to have always gotten the better end of the stick as far as when he plays Druid, but now this is just... this is exactly what you don't want to have, basically.
He has a better poker hand, though.
Oh, wow.
If you match up five card.
Yeah.
So...
pair of sixes
this,
and
this
zeros.
This is where he raises, right?
Yeah, but it is Ghoul into frothing and patron, like, the beginning of the straight?
Yeah, I think so.
I imagine it would be, right? That would be a combo.
Yeah. Maybe folding here is also a good option.
Folding, just calling your next hand.
Yeah.
That would be good. If you had to play with this hand, though, it's not worth tossing that force of nature, I feel like, just because...
You might get double combo. I mean, you could theoretically get Savage War, go for combo, and then do it again. Indeed, the war, you know, could almost die.
I mean, at a certain stage, it just becomes really hard to use both these force of nature,
yeah.
But if you use them for direct damage, that is a possibility.
Still not. I mean, with the double shield block that we see in Dog's hand, I think he feels way comfortable.
So I feel like Dog is already on to Thais. He says he either has seven drops that he can't play yet, or he has a bunch of spells that are situational, such as Savage Roar, Force of Natures, and, you know, maybe another Innervate or something.
Yeah. So what happens if Dr. Boom? Is that a consideration, right? Like, if turn seven hits, what do you do against Dr. Boom?
Well, you can't do anything, but the point is, like, if you play a minion here, like if you play a lot of minions here, then Thais playing a 7-drop means that he can't clear the minions.
Right.
Wow.
So playing minions is actually like really good there.
Well, that's a pretty good card draw for Thais. It couldn't have been better than this, I think. Even Dr. Boom would have been somewhat weaker because Dog actually has a removal for it, right? You can use the ghoul with the to get some damage on the frothing and use the axe to finish off Boom.
He will have an opportunity to use the Innervate as well. If he picks a 4-drop, he could make a case of dropping like Shredder or something else too.
I don't know. Yeah, I guess.
Oh wow. Looking for the
I wasn't anticipating this.
He's probably very afraid of this.
He doesn't trust the frothing. Because if you play the Ancient of Lore, then you leave the frothing berserker to its own devices, and there's a lot of room for disaster with an unstable ghoul already out.
Yeah.
This is how much he respects the patient warrior.
I mean, why wouldn't you? Like, you have no tell on what his hand is. All you know is yours is not going to go anywhere if this frothing stays.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Also, on the backside, you can get punished very heavily if the Ancient of Lore for some reason goes down to an execute, or he already has a weapon, so he knows that he gets challenged immediately.
Wait, it just dies to the ghoul and the war.
Yeah, war axe and the ghoul together just kill it, and the frothing then grows.
But wouldn't you use? I guess he doesn't want to take that damage at all then, because. He says, rather than wait for that, then I'm just going to go with the Ancient of Lore afterwards. And he's rewarded, because there's not anything on the board right now. Mm-hmm. And even though Slam and the War Axe does take it, it's absorbing some of his mana and reducing some of the plays that Dog can make.
Well, there's the combo, but Dog is very, very high health. Just needs Death Spite.
Yeah, do you set it off now? I mean, you'd have to override the War Axe. I think that can only make sense, right?
That's okay. I mean, the War Axe doesn't really get much value, generally speaking, against Druid. It's improved somewhat because of cards like Darkness's Aspen and the Living Roots. But before, usually what the Fire War Axe does is kill a Shredder. That's pretty much it. Nowadays, you know, equipping the Death Spite and always threatening that second activation is huge. It's also interesting because I feel like Harrison Jones has cycled out of the metagame despite the fact that Patron and other weapon classes are still rather dominant. It just feels like people don't really run that weapon hate as much.
I mean, we've seen a lot of Druids run it, though. I think Dog's Druid maybe runs it, if I'm not mistaken.
He
may be the only
one
player. Yeah, I think there might be two players that have
does.
It. Yeah,
that's the interesting thing.
I think Hyped ran it. He drew it and it was dead. In his matchup at the very end there against Patron.
Well, taking a look at Thais's hand, he can innervate out the Emperor Thorsen.
Right.
And that will make the combo only 7 mana, as well as Swipe being able to be squeezed in there. So that's an 18 damage combination just from the hand.
Yeah.
And that's a very intimidating board.
Yeah, Dog, however, is like the perfect answer on 9 mana. He can basically play patrons, get the whirlwind activator, and execute.
Yeah, that whirlwind is a very good draw.
Yeah.
That is, let's see, you kill off with the weapon, you have one patron run into it, so that's 3 patrons that remain.
Sounds right.
Okay, and I like that you know, just sequencing wise, you don't need to actually take an extra damage, so make sure to hit the Dragon Drake. Second whirlwind would lower the 3 health. And also what's really nice too is that you can trade the one health patron in and keep the other ones reasonably healthy, so that way your opponent can't get good trades in.
Yeah, he's gonna have to go for Force Damage Savage Roar defensively. That seems like a horrible play, but he doesn't have the choice, I feel.
I don't feel like that's a super horrible choice, actually, because like patrons have like X amount of threats. And you know, you have your big minions, you have your cantrips like Azure Drake. Exactly.
Huh.
And then you know, just grind them out from there. Because when you clear the board, you also stop their battle rages from happening. So you know, hopefully they don't have that, and their cards are just exactly what Taish has. Just like no.
So do you go Drake swipe Savage Roar to kill everything, or no? There's no way you can't do
about,
that.
Just
no way,
Drake swipe and then just kill off one of the patron, the 3/1 patron, and then you have a 3/3 patron versus a Dragon Drake.
Yeah.
Do you not trust that?
But I mean, a single Inner Rage or Cruel Task. I mean, you've seen one Cruel Task, so I guess it would be reasonable to assume he doesn't have a second one.
Yeah,
they tend to be somewhat exclusive with the other minions.
I guess I feel that maybe the combo is more valuable than it is, but perhaps it's not as valuable. And Tice feels like the priority to clear the board. I mean, to be honest, the quality of his hand is much better than that of Dogs, and he can just outvalue it just with cards like Azure Drake into swipe.
Yeah, it's actually looking pretty good for Tice if Dog doesn't pick up a weapon. I'd say a weapon would be one of the things that Dog's looking for. Deathbite. Probably.
Card draw is also important.
Any type of cycle, like Battle Rage would do it. The thing is, half his deck works.
Right.
Oh, wow.
That's bite it is.
Yeah, looks like he's gonna pick up exactly what he wants.
Still though, if it's just one patron.
Taj is looking for something to play.
It's
I think
not
he wants
the Drake,
to hold off the Azure.
I'll take that.
Something.
That's better than nothing.
It's something, and it can't be targeted by the Death Bite, which is pretty significant if that's all he plays, but I have to imagine he's going to play the Drake here as well, just because there's too much floating mana.
Mm-hmm.
And oh, he got the Ancient of War.
Okay.
I guess we melee down this Armorsmith.
Force a kill on the AoE.
Yep.
If another Whirlwind effect is picked up by Dog, the Shade is gone, but then the Ancient of War has no way to be to die. Like, you'd have to sacrifice a patron to execute it down.
Oh, that's perfect. Oh,
there we
wow.
go.
Wow, that is
that
insane.
Is
the Inner Rage, so that way you can get the 4 patrons. You know, Dog has struggled a lot throughout ATLC finals with just some unfortunate draws at the wrong timing. And of course, a few plays where he seemed to choke. But it seems like this game, he's got that long series in between, has definitely got an opportunity to reset his mind. He's looking in good shape right now.
Yeah, Dog got pretty unlucky in the previous series,
yeah.
So, you know.
The first few matches were a lot of bad luck, but the last patron game we saw, it seemed like, as you said, he was choking maybe on some of the players.
He's one of the first people to admit, like, you know, he didn't play his best, but... now he's getting some good draws when he needs it. He's making some pretty solid decisions.
Could actually just charge and swipe. That would clear it.
Yeah,
it?
I do like that Druid the Claw in charge mode.
That's
just clear off the board.
Pretty fantastic.
Yeah.
And you still get a 4/1.
Wow. That is amazing.
Yep.
And now what is that? Whoa. It works the same way either way.
You have to do that. Never mind me.
No, I thought he was attacking the wrong one, but it doesn't matter if you kill a 3/3 or a 3/2.
Right.
And it's at the stage now where he's used both patrons.
Yep.
Right.
He used one War Song and one Frothing. So basically the last real threat is that Frothing Berserker. Or any mid-sized minions that he can't answer, like if Emperor Thorsten gets a lot of damage repetitively.
Yeah, this Execute, I don't think he'll play right now. I mean, is it really worth using this on one damage in this deck?
No, Armorsmith challenges it.
Yeah, that's it. Like,
okay. Like, I guess it does in the end.
Yeah, and you're at 42 health. He's already used a combination of Force of Nature's Tower Drawer.
This Execute really surprised me.
What's going to also happen that's really interesting is, I think this already communicates to Tice that Dog has Execute, because if he had Cruel Taskmaster or something else, he
would
almost like instantly use
it. Yeah, snap play.
So it's like, well, now he's going to play Armorsmith and he hesitates. So Tice is like, okay, he has Execute. So if I'm Tice, I trade into the
Armorsmith. Wow, that's perfect.
Well, that's what Tice was looking for. As weird as his early game might have looked,
he's bound to hit these kinds of cards eventually.
Right,
exactly. And it was the combo that actually was... yeah. very valuable instead of clearing the board.
So now I see the light, and maybe this is why I never beat patrons as druid.
Yeah. The thing is, Dice is a sick druid player as well, right? Might be the deck that he knows the most.
That and Handlock, I would say, are his two best decks.
Right.
Or classes, or archetypes he's most familiar with.
If I don't see a 10-5 here, I
would
be disappointed.
Uproot that.
Yeah.
You uproot that.
You have to.
Okay, well, here is an actual interesting choice. It's the fact that, the Dr. Boom has to go into the Acolyte, so that you can only draw one card, and then it absorbs so much damage.
But...
what do you do with the Ancient of War after that?
Well, that's fine. I mean, 7-7
Uproot!
Right?
Yeah, he has to uproot this.
No, he doesn't have to.
He doesn't
but
have
I want
to?
Him to.
No, that's not uproot.
For the sex appeal.
Oh, come on.
Do it! No!
Oh, what?
Boom.
Boom.
Your mother was.
Put in Lothar. He'd uproot that.
Yeah, Lothar would do it. And the thing is, like.
And he'd flex afterwards. Yeah. Win-win.
Hmm.
I think that he needs to coach Dice.
Oh man, second battle rage. Everything's just cycling for one.
Oh, well,
okay,
that's convenient.
Something.
I mean, it's going to kill the Ancient of War.
Is it a bigger priority to kill the Ancient of War or Dr. Boom?
Yeah, that's a good question. I'd say probably. You have another execute, so maybe the Dr. Boom to mitigate more damage. You're still looking for the other execute to kill the minion. So, yeah, I think you might be right. It's just better to whirlwind and execute Boom. Question is, like, how do you win without frauding? Like,
just one frauding and one war song left, right?
Yeah, there's one war song, one frauding. He's still, you know, at 43 health right now, right?
Yeah.
So it's not that impossible, but
not bad. Okay. Well, I mean, wild growth. You'd rather just draw the card you would have gotten with wild growth,
right.
But at least you have that mana room to play with.
Yeah.
Ancient of Lore, pretty good pickup. Probably the best that he could ask for, short of another big taunt minion like the Ancient of War that can just seal the game.
Yeah, he's got one more Savage Roar too, right? So he can always find that extra damage to seal the game a bit faster. Not that he's worried about anything really coming from Dog.
Yeah, you already
see
one.
That's a rat. So that means most likely the last Frothing can be dealt with, even if it somehow survived. Dog's gonna have to pass again. His last hope is to slowly but surely chain draw into the frothing the last execute.
Yeah, he's got four cards.
He has two executes. He has two executes and he's only used one, right?
Yeah, there's one left in the deck.
So you're saying that he needs both execute and the frothing?
Yeah, so
he's
gonna buy
everything.
Time. He's gonna have to buy time over two turns.
Yeah, shield block would help a bit.
And even then, I don't know if it's enough.
Yeah, but there is a 20 health, so would you be able to deal 20 with 2-0 in effect? I think you might be able to.
Oh wow. That's gonna shorten its clock.
Changes almost I think I might shorten it down just to one turn.
Yeah, one turn.
This.
So yeah. Touch is one more draw.
Play like both BGH and
it's
the
impossible though. He only can draw one card.
No more battle rages.
No more battle rages.
You're right.
He only can chain draw off of his existing one to draw one more.
Yeah, shield block. No, he's already used up two shield blocks, that's right, earlier on, so he's got nothing left. A slam maybe? I think there might be another slam.
He just needed one more card. I mean, he's gonna pass it to his opponent, but he recognizes that there's a high chance he just dies anyways. There's 15 damage represented on board, and if the opponent has one Savage Roar, it'd be 25,
exactly
which is exactly what he has.
And do you play the ghoul, or do you think you're still dead?
I can understand why he keeps it. He says, my opponent has to be really unlucky, and I have to get somewhat lucky in order to win this game.
And I like how we just eyeball this and say it's lethal.
Yeah, he knows he's dead. Like Dog and Dice are the two players who've played a lot of druids.
One damage over lethal, if he hero powers.
Oh wow. Frodan, good at math.
Actually not just good at math.
Really?
But I am good at taking credit for people's work.
So it looks like you're pretty good at Jeopardino though. Like, you said you were going to be absolutely terrible, but honestly, I think you blew.
I was just decisively mediocre, yeah.
What? No, I disagree.
That's actually kind of how most of my dates go as well. I warn them, like, it's probably not going to be good, but ends up being average. I actually did a lot worse, too, because the points weren't actually there. Some of the values, because we went super fast. I actually got third place, believe it or not.
Oh.
Yeah, I did.
All right.
It's the not so big secret that's out there.
So ATLC is amazing, and Dyson.
Very
Life
short and
are
concise.
Yeah.
I like this guy.
Yeah.
Brad?
Brad,
thank you.
MCC80.
Yep.
You're epic, dude. Now, looking at the next coming match here, we have Druid already gone, which is pretty important just because Druid, even though it does have a decent win rate against stuff, I always feel I'm always fearful for it. When there's like Zoo out there, and you know, there's like the Dragon Priest, which has done much better against Druid recently, and it just feels like even though Druid is not the weakest class by any means, it's just, it's always one of those variables that can just suddenly drop three games for you, and then you're in a big pickle.
Yeah, I'm always interested to see how Druid performs. I wonder if the next phase of Druid, so to speak, is going to be this Nimsh Druid. A lot of people call it that Nimsh actually popularized a bit with the Living Roots and the Druids of the Saber. Is that where Druid is headed? Strife Crow played that and is doing amazing.
Oh man, I heard that list cuts Ancient Floor.
Yeah, it does. It's all in very fast. It's crazily fast all in.
It's such a good card, and you know, it's kind of like another Zoo at that point, right?
Yeah. Well, it's very fast. Think of it more as like hybrid hunter-ish. It's like what you do is you have defensive tools if you want to use it, but like for example the taunt mode of stuff, or you can use removal of spells defensively, but the whole point is to be very aggressive in buffs and chargers and always threaten Savage Roar. And you know, originally a few of us at Temple were like thinking of this like token Druid-esque things when TGT first came out, but we couldn't really figure out a strong list that was consistent because we kept things like Ancient of Lore, but it always made draws very awkward, similar to how Zoo has Mal'Ganis. And it's just like you have that in your opening hand, you're like, oh, I don't actually have anything to play for the first four turns. So it makes a lot of sense when you think of it that way. And it's really cool that Strife Crow was brave enough to bring it to the finals.
Yeah, it's really Living Roots making all these Druid deck lists viable, I think.
Absolutely.
It's like a big winner.
But there's none of them, right? That these two players are playing typical mid range. I mean, Dog might decide not to get benched again. Do you like the dog food that you. That was humiliating.
Oh.
Yeah, that was actually Newberry. Newberry just said, I was like, yeah, you just film on the bench.
Very cool.
And then that kind of happened. It was just okay, I guess.
Very cool.
All right, RDU Shaman's coming out. Let's see if it does as well.
I was kind of scared about this because I feel like Shaman doesn't have a very good timing. The later you save it, the easier you have a chance to corner it. So you feel obligated to just kind of throw it out there. Yeah. But every time it feels tossed out in the early stages, the Shaman has floundered, you know, significantly because it's losing to decks that are just like solid, like Zoo or Hunter.
Yeah,
it's like you're not gonna beat these decks. Like Zoo is so good at board control, and Shaman needs one thing early game, which is board presence.
Exactly. Well, based on the history of ATLC in the online qualifiers, it was Kibler who just steamrolled everybody with the Shaman first pick. And yeah, it worked out really well for him. It's just that after TGT came out, it might not be the best tech now that, you know, you have your Secrets Paladin and your, you know, aspirants with Druid.
Yeah, getting the early board is just not, it doesn't feel realistic anymore.
Yeah, and I mean, like Chris said, right? Already played six games of Mech Shaman, there were 12 Lava Bursts that were drawn.
Yeah,
very, it very feels early. That way.
Yeah.
The trends seem to be in the very beginning of ATLC, that Handlock was very popular. You want to have Handlock to, you know, give you some stability against Patron. It's also pretty decent against some other classes if people brought Rogue, for example. And then the Mech Shaman would kind of slide in there as a weird, like, rock, paper, scissors thing, which loses to other decks, but it kills the Handlock. However, Handlock, no one brought Handlock.
Yeah.
At all. So far.
Wait, actually, no one brought Freeze Mage either. Right?
Freeze Mage at all so
far.
That is
really cool.
And these decks that Mech Shaman was supposed to kill, that takes their time drawing cards and being defensive, Shaman's supposed to be able to pounce on that, and there are no decks like it. So that's why Shaman looks way worse than it might actually be. And it's a little unfair to peg it on RDU and be like, oh yeah, like RDU, why would you agree that?
Yeah. If you expect something different.
Much better because the metagame was different.
Yeah, I think it's interesting because it's all about seizing the early game tempo, and they've only got so many ways to do it. It's all about the god draw, pretty much. Unlike Zoo, which can just tap into answers, I guess.
RDU has a pretty good opening hand.
Yeah, I'm liking this hand from RDU, though. If anything can take out Zoo, the Power Maze gives them the early board control. And yeah, the Inora Troll is pretty tough to remove unless you pick up an owl, which I think Trump runs an owl in his Zoo, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah. I wonder what Trump keeps.
Against Mech Shaman, I mean, you could keep...
You're really looking for that 2-drop, right?
Yeah. Sea Giant Defender, you could throw everything, actually, besides Voidwalker. You're likely to find what you want. It's... Yeah.
Yeah, I think the cards that, like, really punish Mech Shaman the most are things like combinations that seize the board tempo, like Power Blooming on the Egg with the Void Terror, or even, like, Implosion. Like, that by itself can single-handedly really ruin a shaman's day.
Well, speaking of ruin a shaman's day, Trump's about to do just that.
That is, like, the best opening. Oh, man.
This is literally from strong board tempo to defending it while using buffs to get advantageous trades. That has a zoo. This is like a zoo's wet dream.
This is like 2013 Hearthstone.
Yeah.
Man.
Yeah. I remember this from a long time ago. It hasn't changed really. Like, this opener is pretty much classic.
Yeah.
Trump is rock hard right now. Like, this is exactly the type of thing that gets him going.
Ardu just gets...
I heard that. That was...
Yeah.
Okay.
Dude, Ardu is just like...
Oh, I said that.
Every time Mech Shaman... every time he plays Mech Shaman, it's like he's been put in these situations where...
he just knows like he's basically gone through the entire spectrum of emotions.
Yeah.
He did hit that happiness at one point, but he needs to do it again. Because remember, if you win this match, it's a pretty big significant lead. Shaman's out of the way. You got Druid as well out of the way.
I think he can still do it, though, because the power race on turn 4 with 2 mechs is also very strong. There's a good chance he's able to at least buff up the Innoitron and possibly keep it.
Yep.
And then with the Zap-O-Matic on the back end, you know, pick up a Flame Tongue or just a good 4-drop.
Yeah, but like even cards like Defender of Argus can be so big.
Right.
Because it really complicates the board. And we haven't seen cards like Tuskar Totemic make a huge impact either. So RDU is going to need some help here.
Yeah. Well, I'm liking the Earthshock. That's going to simplify dealing with Defender, because one of the minions can probably die to the Power Maze. The other one might just get Earthshock. So,
Earthshock will be huge.
Yeah, definitely. I think just timing it properly is the key here. Wow, that's going to give him a good opportunity to use it, though.
Well, I feel like this is an Innoitron opportunity to get buffed. I think it's a little too optimistic. Well, maybe you can buff the Zap-O-Matic and hide it behind the Innoitron.
Yeah, but then again, Power of Whelming would punish you severely. Yeah.
No, actually, I think you buff the Whirling because you want to dodge the Implosion.
Implosion?
Right?
All right.
Yeah, that's really the only issue here.
That's a great point.
Just bait him into believing he can Implosion Divine Shield. Because when you Implosion Divine Shield, you get zero.
You know, once every week.
I learned that in the first week of GBG, and it was very embarrassing.
That's right, that's right.
Can he even go through? No.
Well, Argus is pretty nice here, but then Earthshock is going to be insane on this egg, like
exactly.
You guys said.
It's
just going
to
be awesome.
It's the punish. And the Tuskar Totemic is also putting a little bit of pressure, depending. Oh my RDU could just Tuskar pick up the spell damage totem and just seal this game.
So obviously, just play Totemic and get a spell power.
Yeah.
The Tuskar Totemic gets the spell power totem.
That would be
really
Earthshock
twice.
Yeah, easy life.
Actually, easy even if you miss, do you just Earthshock twice anyways?
Yeah.
Because
you
might get, like, what if he gets a Flame Tongue totem and he Earthshocks twice and just hits 10
Man. Not 10, 14.
14.
14, you're right.
That is a lot of damage.
This is called hashtag never lifed up again.
And if it's in order to do that, he has to play the Tuskar Totemic to the left.
Oh no, he doesn't go for it.
RDU.
RDU.
You are forsaken.
So that play is because he just doesn't want the Tuskar Totemic to get traded in easily.
Yeah, if it backfires.
But it does the same exact thing as what he just did.
Well, and you get a 3-2.
And you get a 3-2.
I'm kind of surprised by this totem play by RDU.
Well, it's actually like a 1-4. 1-4 chance to get a spell power with the hero power.
And the Tuskar is a 1-7. Because the
Manitai, no, 8.
1-8 is 12.5.
And Totem Golem.
Oh, you're right.
Yeah,
so one and eight.
I don't think you're mad if you get Totem Golem. I'd be pretty happy if I got all Totem right. Golem.
Well,
Totem Golem's my bro. He's actually my best man at my next wedding.
Is he?
Totem Brolem.
All right.
Okay, so now we play him, right?
10 out of 10.
Yeah, it feels that was a really 10 out of 10 joke.
That joke would have killed in the West Coast.
Yeah.
You guys in Texas have no sense.
Oh, he's got a Searing Totem army going here. What do you do with this, VRDU?
Yeah, I think we need a demon here. A big demon.
Demon. Crazy demon!
Warwalker's pretty buff.
See what we have here. Big... Oh, okay, that's also not bad.
That's playable now.
You can play all your hand.
Yeah.
That's actually perfect.
You can play everything.
Yeah.
Just don't trade before you actually drop.
Oh,
but he's pretty low on health, though. Like, both players are weirdly low. I think you might just punch face here, unless you're worried about. You might trade, actually. You have to, because the lava burst and stuff.
Most likely should trade, because of the instance of burst, which is basically the last chance here. And you still have. I mean, you still have an opportunity to 2-turn lethal him.
Yeah, possibly even next turn with a good top deck.
Okay, so that's something.
Is there a way for RDH to actually win from here?
Top deck Doomhammer with that, like getting a Stoneclaw mitigate two. Yeah.
No, it's always the searing. Oh man. Three times searing totem.
Yeah.
I think that's it.
I think the Splitter is trying to fix Mech Shaman. They're just like, he won once. This isn't supposed to happen. We just released TGT.
And it's just like the consistent issue, right?
Right.
Zoo is just so consistent and every card is kind of playable. Meanwhile, the Mech Shaman has like.
He could win, actually. Like, oh no, Crackle have to if so, seven. Yeah, never mind. I was gonna say, like, Topic Crackle, Lightning Bolt, four.
Yeah, that,
okay, so he's gonna bank that Trump's gonna eventually life tap, but I don't if I'm Trump, so. I just don't really life tap, right?
Yeah. But what I might do is trade, and that buys RDU a bit of time. Would Doomhammer save him here? Oh.
Not quite.
Oh, he's just so close to lethal.
If it went for face last turn.
You can afford to dab here. Especially if a demon comes into your hand with Void Caller.
You just double trade and then you go face for 8. Like, what could go wrong? An Oyotron?
Is there a card that deals 10 damage? No, right? But then if you miss... Like, imagine if you miss.
Uh-oh.
No, this is okay.
Oh, that is not a miss.
That is not a miss. That is no. Definitely, that is everything but
yeah,
a miss.
That's pretty, oh, man. That's pretty good.
Is it?
Yeah. You would think so, right?
I think it's pretty good. He used both Urshocks too. So, the effect is good to go.
Oh, man.
I'd be really surprised. RDU would be one of the first Mech Shamans I see to innovate by playing Hex.
Elemental Destruction.
Or Big Game Hunter.
Yeah.
No. That's not gonna do it.
The Pilot Shredder just does not have impact. Shaman drops again. Trump ties up the series. But this was a tough matchup to begin with. We were talking about how Zoo Warlock is one of the most effective classes and archetypes to take out.
Yeah. Go ahead. It's kind of like the anathema of Shaman, I think, where they just can't get aboard ever. It might even be worse than Paladin with Consecration, I think.
Poor Shaman.
Yeah.
Even with like Totem Golem on turn 2, it's just too slow, right? Because you still have to do another turn 2 afterwards with Overload. And nobody's just wearing that deck. You have like your Innervates that gain board control really quickly. You have your life taps to giants, even.
Do you ever think the variance of cards, like the hero power being random for Shaman, you know, and some
it's
of their cards
random.
Being.
Just play just for True Heart.
Yeah, and then you get whatever you want.
Wow.
Yeah.
But then you wouldn't play that
it's
card.
It's not so random, is it?
You wouldn't play that card.
It's
if
actually
the class...
zero value because you can just RNG and get every single red totem all the time.
Yeah. So what he's saying is you're fixing a design flaw by playing Jessica True Heart.
Yes.
Not a design flaw, but a design
well,
that you don't
Blizzard,
like.
Okay, so you have to imagine.
Right.
You have to imagine that Blizzard tested summon two totems.
Okay.
It's like because,
okay.
Because it did summon 2-1-1 recruits. And it's like, okay, this is probably not too broken. It's really good.
Yeah.
They're like, well, what if they summon two totems? And obviously that did not pass R&D. So they say choose any totem and that was okay.
Yeah.
So apparently... Mm-hmm. Is, and I have to think it has to do with, like, the Totemic Might stuff.
Yeah, probably.
Sure, that makes sense.
And also, you know, it kind of reminds me of the whole Hemet needs to be printed because Beast is going to be, like, very dangerous. So definitely didn't pass the testing.
So Shaman
That's
getting
a bad comparison.
Shaman getting to choose their totem apparently is, it could borderline break the game.
Really? But Quartermaster is in the game, you know? I'm not sure.
Yeah, but Quartermaster is no different than, like, Patron Flood. I mean, if you think about it.
Yeah, we have, like they had the Thunderblood Valiant. It's just hard to pull off. Like, getting, I think if Inspire worked, like, better, it was easier to enable, I think Shamans would be fine.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, I just thought of, yes, it's just card, Drew Heart does let Shamans pick the same totem twice.
Right, it could have, like, 7 spell damage and just insta-kill
could.
You. Yeah.
Could.
Theoretically.
But, alas, we'll have to wait to see if that ends up being the case in the future. For now, I think that was a really nice win for Value Town. They didn't really... It wasn't like a must-win situation, but it was like a would like to win.
2-0 as a lead early can also, especially if the Shaman wins, right? We have to like emphasize that. If Nihilim gets away with getting a Shaman out of the way, then you're going to have a harder time going forward because there's a chance you can farm that deck. Like, it seems like a weak spot for them, so it's good to keep it up.
Continues to be so, at least on paper. It's played 7 games. It's lost 6 of them.
Right.
And for now, we're going to go to Priest... versus the Mech Mage. Kibler, he's been doing very well for Value Town so far. I believe he has gone 4-1 Yeah. His two matches. And if he goes another 2-0, then he really lives up to the Master of Duels. Someone should tell him that he already won it, that he doesn't actually have to try as hard anymore for that.
That's a good point. Yep. Since he is, in fact.
Tell him to slow down a little bit.
Yeah. Well, keeping him with the consistency, just saying that, you know, I have the best record in the whole ATLC.
Yeah. It's good to have, you know, you're a good Magic player, and then you transition the biggest tournament that happened. You're like, oh, I got, you know, the best record, so. The non-BlizzCon tournament, of course.
And he's doing it playing Priest. Yeah. But I mean, Priest is in a good spot, though. I mean, I actually haven't seen the resident Priest player on the casting desk play much Priest recently. But how have you been liking Priest since TGT came out?
Yeah, it seems like Priest, the only viable deck right now is the Dragon Priest, which makes me a little bit sad. I do prefer the, you know, Thought Shadow Madness, Recombobulator it, you know, Schickmeister, and then, you know, Cabal it. But Kalento's playing a version of that, which is
it's like a hybrid dragon kind of control priest.
It seems like everything is a hybrid now. And
well, like, because it's halfway, you know.
Everybody wants to do everything. Like, they like to have options now.
Can I please have 40 cards in my deck?
Yeah.
The danger of that, sometimes it does nothing.
You want to do everything, but yeah, it needs to do nothing.
Yeah.
But hey, this hand is gonna do something from Kibler. It's like the dream hand against a mech mage, which is very tempo oriented.
Yeah. The Azure Drake is also, I want to say, better than Twilight Guardian in many cases, just because you can keep it. Whereas Twilight Guardian, if it's the dragon enabling the other ones, there's a chance you never draw something to enable it.
I think that said, I'd still rather have the Twilight Guardian. You have a good point. Sometimes you can't activate it, but like the value of having a strong curve is also really good too.
Oh, that's tricky to handle. Like, do you just skip your turn and ping?
Man, this is already such a good position Cable put himself into, because this coin valence.
Played Zombie Chum.
Yeah. It's going to be insane.
Well, there's no real good answer coming from.
Wow!
That couldn't get better. That just couldn't get much better.
I can understand why. Because you don't want the Mech Warper to survive.
Right.
Never.
Yeah, and, Shredder comes out. What do you do, right?
Shredder comes out.
You could Valor Chosen then.
Yeah,
right?
or just like you lose your chance to kill it. If he plays a Know Your Tron, you can't really get past it.
Oh my god.
He's going to be getting those reduction costs.
Yeah. Feed the Whelp! This is kind of a sacrificial Tinkertown.
This spare part is really bad.
I'm watching Lord of the Rings here.
Well, it's an interesting crossroads because most likely that Twilight Whelp will die no matter what.
Mm-hmm.
If he heals it, it dies to the Clockwork Gnome trade. And if you play the Wormrest Agent, that also just dies to the Fire Blast. But by playing the Wormrest Agent, you at least force your opponent to use their hero power.
Which denies them tempo. That's
unless they're playing Blast Mage. If you want to play around Blast Mage, you kill the Clockwork Gnome and then heal it.
Oh wow, really? I think you just, you know, kill the 4/4 and just drop the 2/4.
Because if you kill the 2/1 and there's a fireball, you lost your opportunity to get rid of the 4/4, and then the next time that comes up is gonna be on Light Bomb perhaps. So it's a bit clunky to leave it out.
I mean, at the end of the day, it's either heal for 2 or drop a 4 health creature, and 4 is bigger than 2, so you might as well, you know, do that instead.
Well, you picked up on the Amaz map.
Yeah. All right. Well, Kibler's gonna choose to save it.
Yeah, so this is pretty good, generally speaking, if you force your opponent to ping. It's very unlikely, even if he gets the Goblin Blast Mage, that 3 shots go into it. So most likely he'll still have to trade, even if in the worst case scenario. And I like that Life Coach is putting an emphasis on putting out this Mad Scientist.
These are the worst 2 spare parts to make Archmage work, so I don't think Life Coach is ever happy. I mean, in the case of a like Blast Mage pickup, where you just bring it back up, that can be okay.
Yeah,
but
it's still very slow, though. Yeah. It's like bad for tempo if you want to use the 5/4.
Oh, well, no mech.
Too slow. We're up to that point where Priest is going to draw a big min every single turn, and the Mech Mage is going to fail to keep up with it.
It looks like it. I mean, his best play on the board is the Blast Mage for tempo, but Spire Tank is what fills out the curve better, and you can use the Goblin Blast Mage next turn.
Yeah, getting the Mirror Entity up also might help. If you're expecting, say, an Azure Drake, which is very frequent in that deck, or some another 4-drop, Dark Cultist, also possible. Like, a lot of cards in the Priest deck you'd like to get. North Shard is not one of them, of course, but...
Wow, double North Shard. That's really, really good.
Yeah.
Yeah, and he can kill it and then heal to draw the card. He had one already, so the second one's luxurious.
Yeah, do you play the Wormer Station instead of the second North Shard? Yeah, it looks like he does. Hmm. Okay, that's gonna work out.
Yeah, what I like about the Wormrest Agent too is just that it survives based off what your opponent will ping, and it just helps protect other cards a little bit better, like your Azure Drake,
yeah,
or your Cabal Shadow Priest. And what you want to do as the priest is to continue to just control the board and draw the cards off Northshire Cleric while you can. You're not in any danger of your opponent burning you out yet.
And Blast Mage seems like the only play. But what's the follow-up, right? You can't play Archmage on an empty board. You could go for, like, Mirror Entity Snowchugger on the turn 7 with a ping. That's probably the only thing you can do.
The play is to shoot Twilight Guardian 4 times.
Oh, 2 or 2.
That could work out. I mean, you kill 2 minions instead of just the 1.
Yeah, you kill Northshire Cleric too. That ends up being pretty okay.
I think you're very good, in fact. I think it's almost the best it could have been. Another hit somewhere else would have been better instead of the Guardian, but...
Yeah, I would assume that he wants to kill off the Twilight Guardian, and then ping the Northshire Cleric, because playing the Snowchugger is right before turn 6, and we know what comes out in turn 6 with the Priest.
Well, that's a good answer.
It's very decent, yes.
Yeah. Would Northshire attack heal as well afterwards? That sounds like a decent segue. But do you need to keep the Shadow of Death for Archmage? Because there's a chance Life Coach just drops it, right?
Yeah, that's true.
He'd have to Light Bomb afterwards.
It's actually a higher likelihood he plays Dr. Boom on 7 than plays Archmage.
Right, but you're not expecting it.
You have Light Bomb.
So, yeah. So he might feel comfortable enough to just use Shadow of Death here.
Yeah.
You get heal as well.
Yeah, it's an extra card, plus you get to kill the 5-4.
Clear the board.
It's good sequencing. Make sure to do this first, instead of Shadow of Death first.
What would you draw would change your mind?
Second Shadow Ward Death.
Oh, right.
So you use the top deck one instead.
Oh, and that's
then you
good.
Can trick your opponent.
Trick
your opponent to stinging that you don't have a second one. Right?
You have to wave in a thank you or sorry.
Oh, yeah.
So that way
okay.
You can really show that it's a top deck.
But that looks like a trick from Kibler. He looks like he's trying to trap you. You wouldn't fall for that.
Not people fall for traps all the time.
Yeah, even from somebody who's like not known for BM.
Yeah. All right. Especially if you're not known for BM,
okay,
you can actually pull out these tricks a little bit more.
Okay.
Well, I think you just try to get a good spare part. I think you know that Snowchugger will get stolen. You can't really, you know, deny that. But the Clockwork Gnome, maybe it gives you that stealth spare part that can keep the Antonitis cloaked.
Speaking of another death, what if you actually take the Clockwork?
That would be actually a very good play. But no, Trigger, I think, is a little bit too insane.
Yeah, the tempo that it can do, you can game if it freezes Dr. Boom, for example, or something.
Okay, are we collecting them all? Time Rewinders?
Yeah, probably.
I think if you get 3, it's a jackpot bonus, right?
Yeah, and then you deal 30 damage to the opponent's face. Aww.
Finicky Cloakfield could have helped, actually, because then if you pick up a really cheap minion, I was going to say. Like, in this case, it would have worked out, because you go Archmage, Finicky Cloakfield into Cogmaster, into Time Rewinder. Like, that would actually given you, like, an extra 2 fireballs that you otherwise would have never had.
No, that's true.
It's a marginal
not
position
in this case though, but like even if Life Coach's hand all turned into fireballs, I don't think it would still work.
Yeah, I mean the priest would probably be able to beat
him
down.
It's a pretty extreme thing though. Like if he had 5 fireballs, had to do 30 damage over the course of 3 turns.
Yeah, the priest would probably
be able to do it. I would say he had a chance.
Okay. So yeah, we can see that if Antonis was actually coupled with a spare part of the stealth. That would have been pretty close.
But it's not.
Yeah, that's not the case.
What we're saying is Kivler's in a great spot and Life Coach isn't.
Okay.
How do you even utilize this ping very effectively? It doesn't seem like it does very much because of all the odd number of health here. So you can't really ping past anything and then trade.
Yeah, just rewind the dragon, I guess.
Kivler's happy. It's not a finicky Cloakfield.
I guess you can buff it up as well.
Yeah.
Why not?
But it does get Shadow of Death.
Yeah, it doesn't really change much.
And that is going to be yet another card drawn. I think, Kibler, once again, just in a very dominant position for the board. But this is supposed to be what happens.
When Priest
a few months ago, not a few months ago, maybe like half a year ago, when Mech Mage was still very prevalent, and people were like, "Oh yeah, like this is one of the best decks, and Priest sucks." I heard from a source within Blizzard that Mech Mage's like lowest win percentage against matchup wise is Priest.
I have no doubt about that. Yeah, even back then. But the thing is, since the entire metagame wasn't just Mech Mage, you really couldn't play Priest. But yeah, it did make sense.
Because people were like calling out, like, "Oh, like how do we beat Mech Mage? We can't really beat it consistently without like killing our win rates." And like, no, just play Priest.
Was it because Priest versus Mech Mage was only locked like 2 games?
Could be the Kalento effect, I think.
Okay.
I think it also had to do with just like, Mech Mage, you could always clear the board with Circle of Healings back in the day. Yeah. And Shadow Madness was pretty good against whatever they played.
You just slap that Ysera. I can't imagine you wouldn't.
Almost anything here is board dominant. You've killed his Antonitis.
There's two spare parts.
You're going to be able to deal with Dr. Boom. And you have more cards. You have better, you have dragons. You have nice, sleek, gray, shiny hair. You have a play mat with your face on it. You have a dog that's adorable. It's a Pomeranian. I think Kibler is set.
He's got it all, man.
He's got Master of Duels title and 5k in his pocket.
Mm-hmm.
What else does he have?
What's his next step, then?
4k dinner.
Well, like, I guess his next step is to get enough money for the wedding, because the marriage costs so much.
Oh, yeah, he was telling me.
He's getting married, is he?
Yeah, he's like, if I win all the money, I'm going to spend it directly on the wedding.
And it's right after ATLC, too.
Yeah, interesting. It's actually next week. Were any of you invited?
I wasn't.
I wasn't either.
Yeah.
Wow. We're not
feels
dragons.
Really bad.
Yeah, he's laughing at us.
He heard us.
Oh, he's like, nah.
He heard us.
Oh, man.
Yeah, he's actually listening.
What a jerk.
Yeah.
Look at
that smug face.
He's like, yeah. I said I didn't have any more invites, but I did. All right, well, basically, there's nothing we can do here. And the Boombot's hitting optimistically to kill the Azure Drake.
Yeah, kamikaze and mode. Maybe we'll kill the Drake. But I don't. Even that sounds like far-fetched. Okay. That sounds pretty far-fetched. Hey, you return Dr. Boom, get more Boombot hits.
Man, Killer can't keep his excitement down.
He's like, I'm undefeated almost. Almost.
Yeah, he did drop a game. I think it was to Tice.
Oh, yeah.
Dr. Boom on turn 3.
Right, that was a bit unfair.
It's a bit hard to beat that one.
I mean, just Shadow or Death would have saved him.
He even had a chance that game, too.
Yeah, he wasn't that far.
It wasn't, like, unwinnable for him despite that. It was like there was still a small chance he could have won there.
It's funny how these two players don't mind the game dragging on. Life Coach might just concede
that. Yeah, Life Coach is done. He's done with this.
He's like, okay, you have too many good minions. Like, I think Life Coach's last hope is if Kibler had all situational spell cards, like more light bomb stuff, and less like actual minions. And then maybe Life Coach held on with the idea that he has a flame strike or something.
Yeah.
And he can climb back on the board. But it'd be very unlikely, because I don't know why else you would want to face off against that many minions.
Yeah, we were talking about that earlier, right? Like, if he had a flame strike in his list, he would actually be able to come back. There was a position as well, which happened, I think, in the last series. So Valiant's up 2-1 against Nihilum. It's not really that big of a deal early. I mean, we're still in the very early phases of the match.
Mm-hmm.
It could go either way still, like it did last series. You know, we had a reversal, 4 wins in a row from Nihilum.
Overall, it just seems like Nihilum's mech decks have not been, performing as well as it should be.
Well, the mech mage from Life Coach has been doing well, I think.
Did okay. Yeah, I mean, it's only played a few games.
Yeah.
The Shaman's played a lot of games.
Yeah.
And the mech mage has outperformed the mech shaman so far. But it realistically could be like mech shaman wins the next match, and then mech mage loses 4 games. And then who's the real culprit here? You tell me.
Yeah, it's actually hard to evaluate, because it feels like both decks suffer from an inconsistency. But I think cards like Mad Scientist, giving yourself an immediate tempo gain, make this a little bit easier.
Yeah, I would say so. The Mad Scientist is still really effective in... when you bring out the Mirror Entity. I know people were originally talking about it seems like no one brought Fel Reaver with Mech Mage, and I think that was like the big recent revitalization, especially in the Chinese server and a few other places. You'd slap in Fel Reaver, take out Mad Scientist and the Secret, so that way you have more consistency. Sometimes you draw the Secrets.
Right.
Or sometimes you draw Scientist, but Secrets already in hand, and it's like, doesn't really matter. So the Fellreaver is supposed to bring that up. And then I guess Eloise took it a step further and said, instead of Fellreaver, I'll play Clockwork Knight and play Tron.
Yeah, and I actually like the Clockwork Knight in mech decks. It's largely undervalued. The thing is, the deck still can't salvage the lack of card draw, right? When you don't draw on curve, when you don't curve out, it's pretty much impossible. Whereas you have other decks that are, you know, still, sure. like Druid, right? Like, they can still play that new deck with a bit of a better, smoother curve.
So knowing that Life Coach just lost, yeah. But it feels like people aren't really afraid of the bench rule these days.
No, not at all.
You just have to account that Life Coach might queue up again and just play Patron.
Yeah.
I feel like it's still an okay time to send Dog out again to just play Patron one more time. Although, like, what is Druid good against that was gone and now he can play? I don't really think anything.
Yeah, so. there's nothing there for Dog's Druid to really exploit.
I feel like it's just fine. Like, just go ahead and queue up something from Dog.
You could queue up with, I mean, into Patron, I guess you have a chance, right? It's probably, like, your better matchup,
and
perhaps.
Stop leaving Dog by himself, like, at the very end. They always do this with Valley Town.
I don't know what's up
like
with that, right?
Guy. Well, Dog is the last guy because Druid is just really bad at all the matchups, right? You want to give it as least chances as possible.
The most chances.
The least. So that if you put it at the end, then it doesn't matter, right? You just want the other classes to win immediately. And then the last deck has like, oh, if you can win this game, you don't play anymore. So in that sense, I kind of feel it as like the least amount of opportunities that you need to use that deck.
Yeah.
Does that make sense? Because if you play it early...
Are you calling Druid good or bad?
No, I mean, it's bad right now in this specific matchups, right? Oh. So that's why they're not bringing it first, because in the chance that they lose of it, they have to bring another thing. Whereas if they brought something like what they're doing now with Paladin, and Paladin has an easier time, then, you know, just more chances to win.
I agree, but from the exact opposite perspective. Like, in the sense that I'd rather play my best decks first, so I give the most chances for Druid to win. It's like the same exact thing as you're saying.
Well, but Druid is the worst matchup, right? So you're actually playing the worst deck. So your chance to win, say, is 30% every time, whereas if you bring a good deck, it'll be a 60%, but you have to play the 30% anyways later on.
Yeah. Actually, I agree, but just from a different opposite perspective.
Oh.
You're talking about the least bad. I'm talking about the most good. Because if you're up like 5-1, that means you have 5 games of Druid to at least try to hit.
Right. So that's why you don't pick Druid.
Right.
First.
That's what
exactly.
Saying.
Okay.
So we agree. We agree.
I don't know what that was all about, but no. There's a Fiery War Axe in Life Coach's hand.
That's a good one.
Yeah, one. Great one. I don't even know. I mean,
it might be the only one too.
You think so?
Yeah.
It might be. I'm not saying it is. We've seen people run double Fiery War Axe.
Yeah.
But if that's the only one, then that's a very fortunate draw.
Yeah. Life Coach is actually one of the players who plays like one Owl in Handlock. The one War Axe in Patron would make sense as well.
And he
gets
away with it every time.
Yeah, every single time the Owl's on time. I think the reason is he rarely ever silences off his Watcher, where some people still do, even after the metagame shifted so much.
No, silencing your Watcher is still very effective.
Yeah.
If you play two Owls, if you're playing Life Coach's list, use it to silence.
Right.
Because you need it for Sylvanas and Shredders and like really other powerful
Tyrians.
Things.
Any bucks.
Tyrians.
Yeah. Valence shows it, which always feels bad because the main is already pretty chunky and priestless, so you're not really silencing much. Alright, so...
Okay, so a pass. I guess it's all about Life Coach thinking what he does on the following turns, because most likely he's like evaluating, okay, if he plays mini bot, what do I do versus Knife Juggler. Now, Trump is in a position where he can once again go into the position that... who was the one playing against the coining out the Knife Juggler versus coining out the mini bot?
Strifco was
right.
Yeah,
I believe
he ended up doing the mini bot because he believed it was the Fiery War Axe because
he was afraid of the Fiery War Axe.
Exactly,
and I think that's a really interesting lesson that like because guys like Trump were watching. I wonder if he's going to like change his opinion. Like, oh, I go Knife Juggler first for more damage, but in this case, he does get punished. But next turn, he has. Like Noble Sacrifice and Knife Juggler.
Exactly.
Yeah, I would probably prefer keeping the Knife Juggler for turn 3 in that case. But there's a chance Life Coach doesn't even pop the spider. Although he does have the whirlwind, so there's really no incentive not to.
I do like the creeper here more. Even, the Noble Sacrifice is effectively a 2-1 taunt and also spawns a knife.
Yeah.
And it gets propped.
So Life Coach could choose to armor up and go for Fire War Axe Whirlwind next turn if he wants to. But then again, if there's secrets coming out, you might feel a little uneasy about letting stuff live. Yeah.
The real challenge is, I think Trump was agonizing over, is what if his opponent coins an Acolyte out?
Yeah.
He actually can't do anything to that.
Yeah.
So he's just evaluating, like, is it better to be safer here, where my opponent has potential to punish, versus play the very smart, consistent route with my curve and feel good about it. And yeah. I think this is ultimately better.
Yeah, using the coin up on your opponent anyway is probably, like, against Patron, you're probably happy to have him use up the coin on Acolyte early, I guess.
It's rare to be able to play around everything in right. an efficient manner.
Yeah, see, Life Coach just develops the axe and doesn't bother attacking with it.
So. Sean must be very happy about himself. Playing that creeper first.
Yeah, because then it's like it's confirmation that what you thought was correct.
Yep.
And a lot of times people use confirmation bias improperly, but in this case it was correct. Oh, no! Trump logged out.
Yeah, and the camera's not allowing him to be
a
on.
A money tower's playing in his steed.
Oh. It was actually like orange earlier, right? Alright, so Life Coach. I mean, the double whirlwind is going to come in really handy. Now you have to play around the secret, of course. So if you attack the juggler and it is, in fact, Avenge, then you're buffing the spider, and that just can't feel good.
Avenge or Noble Sacrifice is problematic.
Yeah, I mean, Noble Sac, at least it's not that bad. You get a second swing with the Fire War Axe. But the follow-ups worry you, right? Like, Shredder is always a problem in this deck. You know that it's curving up more mid-rangey. Even Divine Favor is almost scary. Man. One drop plus Divine Favor just early could also work.
This is already really hard to deal with.
Yeah, the sheer amount of choices of what those secrets could be. And you know that Paladins, these kind of Paladin also just is willing to throw any kind of secret. So there is a significant chance that your opponent just play like Repentance. And just,
yeah, and like you play, you can't even play Frothing into it. Yeah. That's the issue, right?
Repentance is probably the least bad, right? I think you want your Frothing to get Repentance.
Yeah, because that way you can kill the juggler without an issue.
But oh man.
This Blessing of Kings is going to get some crazy value.
It's the juggle. Oh, hits that. I'm not really sure it changes anything.
Oh, the other juggler, it might. That's like four knives.
Oh yeah, play the juggler.
That's crazy amount of knives. That's five knives. But then you're really open to a whirlwind play.
That's six knives.
Yeah, you're still like, it's like six knives with the extra.
He also can't kill both jugglers at the moment on board, and then you also have the Blessing of Kings on the shielded mini bot afterwards. I think this is probably by far the strongest play that Trump has.
Yeah, well, with double whirlwind, I think Life Coach is going to get out of it without too much of a problem. But now, without that, it would be an issue.
Now, what would you do, Noxious, if all juggles here missed the Frothy Berserker from this point on? Will you shave your beard?
Yes.
Oh!
Just say yes! You just said yes!
I should have said yes. I mean, the odds were in my favor, really. I think it's too late, right? It doesn't count.
Yeah, that's okay.
Or, what a waste that
I was.
I was
just putting you on the spot.
Yeah. I was like, I would have done it, probably. Like, if I said yes and I'd acknowledged it, I would have probably done it, and I would have casted the tomorrow without
chicken
a beard.
At the end.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
No worries. No worries, man.
Angry chicken, man.
I think the fact that you have a beard already proves how manly you are relative
to I'm sure it does. I'm sure it does.
It does.
Yeah.
Well, this is one way you can dissect the Patron Warrior. I know a lot of people are always feeling confounded about how to take out this deck. And the key is just that pressure. He's at 16 health if he swings at something, one of these jugglers. And most likely his play is just to play very defensively with AoE clears.
Yeah, which removes a lot of his win condition for the Patron spam. And then the Shredder is going to stick unless there's another weapon. And if there is, you can probably Kings whatever comes out of this. Mm-hmm. So
naturally, you can use an Erase here.
You would?
In the Whirlwind again.
Yeah, I guess.
And just keep the...
Yeah.
Okay. Instead of using the Axe.
It's better against Divine Favor. That's for sure.
Oh, trying to get more value.
No.
Out of the Whirlwind? Actually,
Is he considering keeping it to get a card draw from the Acolyte?
Yeah, without the draw Acolyte, it's pretty juicy to keep it. But how much damage are you looking at? You're looking at 8 damage plus 2 for every minion drop?
I don't think so. I don't think you can realistically do this. It's too dangerous.
I think you also, again, don't put yourself in a position to get punished by Divine Favor.
Right.
Just use some of these resources. And hopefully your opponent will have a weak turn, which he doesn't. Shredder is pretty good.
Shredder's decent.
Decent, yeah. They have a weird way of putting things. I like Shredder in this position. Does it get better in this Paladin deck?
Yeah.
Maybe Argent Squire with a Blessing of Kings?
Because, I mean, you do play like Redemption and stuff like that, right?
Alright.
Defrado is basically Divine Shield in that sense. You do want it to come back up.
You could have actually done, you're right, the Redemption with this.
And you could also do something, you know, funky with Avenge if you play it in the right order.
Right.
Yeah.
Alright, so a little bit of a weird turn for Life Coach. Are there really that many options?
I mean, Acolyte in a Rage challenges the Shredder.
You can still pick up a Fire War Axe if you play 2 to kill the Shredder, but You're still taking the phase damage, ultimately. Looks like he's going to charge the Acolyte with Inner Rage, draw the card, and kill the Shredder at the same time.
Okay.
Two card draws, not too bad. And then Zap-O-Matic comes out.
Wow.
Yeah.
I think,
just another little walk.
Yeah, give us a Cho. Just I just want to see
another
Cho.
One?
Yeah. Oh, he plays two Axes. Alright.
Yeah, two Axes for Life Coach. Okay.
Another War Song?
No, it's just Scrubs.
Yeah, and they're not gonna do much here because Trump has to decide. I guess you could still justify going for this. The Kings and King, the War Song.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
But, like, you're playing a Squire here. Not really the biggest threat.
There's very few cards that demand such a drastic response, but War Song Commander is definitely right.
Yeah, yeah. Playing a dude is fine.
So Trump is just waiting for that mysterious challenger.
Life Coach is waiting for that execute.
So, yeah,
well,
I guess
he could still just continue drawing here.
That's one way.
I think... I'm trying to evaluate if Gnomish Inventor has any place versus using... I don't think using the second War Song Commander is very wise, but it might be one of those desperate times things as late, as the game develops.
Yeah, but how do you win from here, right? Like, what was the swing turn? You've used two Whirlwinds, so Patient Spawns rely on your Deathbite, and the Ghoul, right?
Yeah, let's start with Gnomish and see what happens.
The Gnomish could pick up the Execute. The thing about playing the War Song Commander is just that it's your second one. So if you lose that, then you lose the ability for Grim Patron to have major impact immediately. And you have to wait a turn, which is just the difference between living and dying sometimes.
Well, no, like, the thing is, War Song Frothing, killing a 1-1, would give you a 4-4 Frothing, right, which demands an answer as well. But Chosen for Champion makes that really weak. So the Axe also allows you to take out that 6-4 afterwards. Oh! Alright, he's gonna opt to put down two threats that kind of demand a different type of answer.
Yeah, I mean, the 6-4 defies can only swing to one of these creatures. Yeah,
nice curve there, Trump.
I actually like Life Coach's play a lot there. It's good.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's really cool. It's really clever because, like you said, it forces reactions because you want both of these to go down and not give your opponent any chances. I think at the same time, though, the Frothing Berserker seems to be a bigger priority because ultimately, if your opponent's drawing a lot of cards, inevitably when you hit Divine Favor, it's going to be okay. Versus the Frothing Berserker might get out of control.
Well,
can it really when you're on 30 here? Like, two Whirlwinds have been seen. I guess the Ghoul will be the biggest issue. You don't have a weapon, so you can't really handle it well. I think it makes sense.
I agree with this attack.
Yeah, makes sense.
I can understand where it's coming from. Like, and this is actually like growth from Trump. I always feel like Trump's one of those players who's like, no, do not get cards, that's not value, you know. Uh-huh. Just like playing from a mindset where sometimes the inner arena player comes out here.
Oh, that's actually a really good pickup for Life Coach, because he could face tank the Shredder and wipe the board. If what's inside the Shredder has one health, I think.
Oh, but then you really want to draw the extra card, though.
Yeah, you attack the...
the extra card is pretty big.
Yeah, the Ardent Squire.
Or just execute or something along those lines.
Show that first.
Does that change his turn ever? Because I feel like going for the Ghoul charge is just... With the Axe, is hard to say no to.
It's true. It's a good point. I think the really difficult part of it is that he still has the mana to do it otherwise, so
yeah,
it doesn't really change too much. Like you said.
Well, would you have actually used the War Axe on the Shredder first?
I don't know, because if an Oya Chuan or Frostwolf Brunt or RoboCub or whatever one of those two drop with taunt comes out, I'm out of it. Basically.
Right, but here you're just conceding the War Song Commander, right? As
you could attack into the Shredder and see what comes out, I guess. I mean, yeah, it's pretty much gone.
But yeah, but you would have done that the other way around.
Right, right.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I think now that Life Coach stops and thinks, I think you're correct. That was a small little sequence there, which may or may not cost Life Coach, depending on how the Shredder drops.
Here we go.
It's just Challenger is getting more and more likely by the second. Huh. That's a really high pressure redemption. Well, if he doesn't do it, though, it tells Life Coach exactly what's going on. But can he even play with that information? Because he still has to do it anyway. Still has to remove the minions.
Okay, I think you have to, you just have to kill the War Song. Patron is just too big a threat if you leave it up. But then you don't get value out of your redemption. Oh, maybe another mini bot comes out.
Yeah, maybe you do get another shield mini bot, right? Okay. Or Lore Walker Cho. So play redemption first.
Wait, no.
The problem with playing redemption first is that you don't know what comes out of the Shredder, and it could be something very bad.
Yeah,
right.
That you don't want, like, explosive sheeps, and then it comes back again, and then it kills the board.
Then you die.
and Patron would be getting Grim Patrons off of their explosive shields. Right. I mean, that's a very fringe scenario, and you don't really talk about these corner cases much when you're calculating.
Well, no, there's unstable ghoul as well, so it's actually pretty relevant.
Two cars is maybe a problem. Oh.
That's a good one.
Wow.
Yeah, pretty good outcome here.
Oh. Now this is pretty good redemption.
I'd do it just because he might not kill the 1-1 because it's not
hero
a high
powers. Yeah, but he hero powers, so ultimately it's not as significant.
What does Life Coach think his opponent's holding on to? It's not Divine Favor because it would have been played. Ah, that's a good pickup for Life Coach. Actually, he can wipe this board with Slam. That's right. That's it. The board's pretty much gone.
Yeah, Trump's last few draws were really just
blanks. Very valuable. Mysterious Challenger top deck carries, but
Mysterious Challenger would be pretty good.
Yeah. I mean, the executes still haven't been drawn from Life Coach. There's a good chance he finds one very soon.
I mean, he got Shield Slam. I can see him using it here, but he doesn't really need to. He could slam and Fiery War Axe and he'd be fine.
Yeah. I mean, there's really he's not dead. There's no way he just dies out of the blue.
In fact, it's one of those things, too, where it's like fighting card inefficient, again, restricts your opponent's ability to come back into the game. And when you have some decent minions that you're going to eventually pick up, like Grim Patrons and even Effort Borison, you can get a lot of mileage out of them.
Yeah, the 5/5 doesn't get answered by Paladin.
Would you slam the 3/2 and then just like kill off the mini bot?
Yeah, probably. I mean, no, I would slam the 2/2, sorry. You gotta get the card
drawn. I wouldn't slam the 2/2, because then the mini bot just gets a free trade on the Armorsmith. Yeah, and you kind of lost the slam for no reason. Just slam something else.
I guess the 1/1 would survive and they would still challenge the.
There we go.
That's the card he's been looking for. Yeah.
Is it too late? Is it too late? Because now, as you can see, Life Coach has a shield block and shield slam.
Oh, you're right.
So if he can deal with, if Life Coach can deal with this effectively and order correctly, then it should work out pretty well. Because when you know that your opponent plays 5 secrets, you know exactly what they are.
Right.
And they don't trigger kind of like hunter traps where some trigger before the others and whatnot. There's always like a set way of dealing with it.
Yeah, but the execute still, like between the shield slams, the shield slam and the slams drawing cards, there's definitely a possibility that the execute just takes away the danger.
Alright, we'll have to see where Avenge procs here.
Yeah, if it goes on the bigger minion, that's a little, I would say, unfortunate.
Yeah, it will be unfortunate.
Mini boss the best case, and...
That's really bad.
That's the worst case.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Even mini boss not that good, because it still dies to a single shield slam, but then a 6/6 at least does something.
Yeah, it's spread out, so that way it's less impactful. So this is a good opportunity for Life Coach to seize the board.
Well, seems like Mysterious Challenger is, you know, not too overpowered after all.
No, I mean, if Patron can beat it, then I guess it's not OP, right?
Takes an OP deck to beat one.
Yeah.
Ah, nice meme, guys. Nice meme.
Nice meme.
I think the Grim Patron can't get played because it reduces the health of one.
So
he's in a very awkward spot for the future turns of what he wants to put as one health. Maybe the Emperor, or maybe he just gets another cool Taskmaster or something.
Yeah. I mean, Cog Hatter would be pretty sweet here, I think. But not that it would do much, but...
Not bad, that's not awful.
There's no more war songs for the Patron to abuse. So it's going to take like a few turns before the Patrons really start replicating.
I mean, it's board presence, and your opponent's already used a lot of Whirlwinds.
Do they play Quartermaster? I could swear I've seen it somewhere.
I think I've seen it in Strife Crow's deck.
Oh, that might be it.
It's probably the case here.
That might be it.
The big thing that you might see in Trump's decks is whether or not he tops out at bigger mid-range or bigger minions you might see in mid-range decks like Tyrion and
Dr. Boom.
Or Control. I mean, those are both viable.
Yeah.
All types.
So let's remember there is a Repentance.
There is a Repentance. That actually gives... a really free. There you go.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, we would do that.
Sure, and then play Grim Patron afterwards.
Yeah, definitely.
So Repentance and the Redemption is still there, which is also kind of bad for Patron because more 1/1s will come out.
What about a buff?
Oh,
Secret Keeper.
That's not what we want to see. That reminds me of drawing Undertaker.
Like, yeah, exactly.
Very, very late back then.
Yeah. Which is why I feel like sometimes the faster decks. I mean, I think he's running a one of Secret Keeper, right?
Well, maybe.
So a lot of people run like a single one.
In my mind, it's not like